a gift to me and you. Only one has ever died and rose again, back to life for me and you. Only one could ever face the cross. Only one could ever save the lost. Who can write his name upon our hearts? And who can give our lives a brand new start? And who reminds us who we really are? Loves us through and through. That's what God can do. Only one who can reign, Lord of all, and his name is Jesus. Only one is the King, ruler of everything, Jesus. Only one is full of love and grace. Only one is worthy of our praise.
Things on. Can y'all hear me okay? I don't know if I can get undressed. There it comes. It is great to be here today. We have the unbelievable privilege of baptizing four individuals. And today I'm preaching on the church. And Jesus revealing himself, who he is, and he says in Matthew 16, upon this rock I will build my church. And the rock he's talking about is himself, the gospel, who he is. But every church has markings. And Jesus, when he hung on the cross, he died on the cross. And after he died, the Gospel of John says that they pierced his side. And out of his side came blood and water. Blood and water. These are the makings of the church. We are washed in the blood of Jesus Christ that cleanses us from all sin. And then we go through the water as a symbol of that inward transformation. Baptism does not save us. It is an outward statement of our inward transformation. And so today, these four are saying early on in life that they are identifying with Jesus Christ. This is what gets you killed in foreign countries. Getting baptized and identifying with Jesus as the dead, buried, and resurrected Messiah. When you identify Jesus in that light and you claim him as that, that puts a target on your back. And so our young people here are saying boldly before you that they are accepting Jesus as Savior and they're burying their old self and going to raise and walk out of here a new person. Amen? And that is exciting. So I'm going to have Sam come. Sam Gilmer. Many of you may not have been in the early service last Sunday, but Sam had never been baptized. He was saved, but he had never been baptized. And so we actually found out by looking him up. He was our guinea pig for our new Realm program. And we went into, and we realized he had never been baptized here. So we found out that had never been taken care of. So Sam came down last Sunday, and he said, I'm ready to be baptized. I want to get that right. There may be somebody out here today. You've been saved, but you haven't been baptized. You need to get that straight. That's something that we believe in. That's something our Lord told us to do. So Sam, have you put your faith in Jesus Christ? He is the only way to heaven. Do you believe that? Have you repented of your sins? All right, Sam, your faith is in him, right? Sam, by your profession publicly here of your faith in Jesus Christ is the only way to heaven. By the power given to me by First Baptist Honey Path and Jesus Christ the Lord, I baptize you now, my brother, in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Buried in likeness of his death, raised to walk, newness of life. Come ahead there, buddy. This is Silas. It's a good name. You start praying and singing, the walls might come down. Silas, take my hand there, buddy. Other hand. There we go. We'll do it like this. Silas, have you put your faith in Jesus alone? And you believe he's the only way to heaven? You've repented of your sins? All right, Silas, by your public profession in Jesus Christ today, by the authority given to me by First Baptist Honey Path in Jesus Christ the Lord, I baptize you, my brother, in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Buried in likeness of his death, raised to walk, newness of life. Come ahead. Little Jack, this is Jack Brown. Jack got saved at my house about 6 weeks ago, something like that, and he was ready. Jack, you know you put your faith in Jesus Christ, and he is your only way to heaven. Have you repented of your sins, Jack? All right, Jack, by your profession in Christ today as your Lord and Savior, by the power given to me by Jesus Christ the Lord and First Baptist Honey Path, I baptize you now, my brother, in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Buried in likeness of his death, raised to walk in the newness of life. This is Sis. This is Jessa. Jessa got saved in my house the other night too. Same night, double whammy. Can I have your hand there, Jessa? You can hold your nose with the other, okay? Jessa, have you put your faith in Jesus? Is he the only way to heaven? Have you repented of all your sin? All right, Jessa, by your public proclamation of Jesus Christ as your Lord and the power given to me by the Lord Jesus Christ and First Baptist Honey Path, I baptize you now, my sister, in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Ghost, buried in likeness of his death, raised to walk in newness of life. Now it's time to sing. Amen? All right.
Good morning. That's a good way to start a worship service, isn't it? If you will, please stand with us and sing. We're going to start off with King of My Heart. Good.
What a wonderful name it is. Nothing comes Death could not hold you, the veil tore before you, you silenced the boast of sin and grave. The heavens are roaring, the praise of your glory, for you are raised to life again. You have no right. Nothing can stand against. What a powerful name it is, the name of Jesus. What a powerful name it is, the name of Jesus. What a powerful name it is, the name of Jesus.
On Christ alone, our chief cornerstone, no other foundation can we build upon. Not philosophy, nor the wisdom of man, all other ground sinking sand. Upon this rock you build your church, and the gates of hell will not prevail. When we bind and loose, we proclaim thank you.
build your church, build it from the ground up. It's your church, build your church, build your church, build it from the ground up. We're your church,
build your church,
build your church, build it from the ground up. It's your church,
build your church, build your church,
build it from the ground up.
Man, if that song don't get you moving, I don't know. Makes me want to fight hell with a water pistol. You know what I mean? It's like, give me a water gun, right? Turn in your Bibles. If you have children and you want to take them to Sunday school, you can send them that way. They'll be taken care of. Today, 11 years ago today, you all called a youth pastor. Mr. Jamie Williams has been here 11 years today. Now, normally, he's not here in the first service, but he came in the first service this morning to watch Heather sing in the choir. And he, after I got done saying that, I walked over. He goes, they think I'm here for the shout-out, you know. I said, no, he had no idea I was going to stand him up today, but... If you go downstairs in the youth area and you look on the wall, you look at all the kids that have come through this church in 11 years. You just think about all the lives. And many of them are in ministry. Many of them are pastoring, working in the mission field. That's what it's all about. And he has invested in my son. Next Sunday, will be moving up to the youth program here. And I couldn't be more happy. For my son, I have utter confidence that I can put my children in our youth ministry. And I know they're going to hear about Jesus and they're going to see Christ not only heard about, but lived out in daily life. Amen? When you go to a movie theater or let's say a drama theater, you go to Broadway, you go to maybe the Mill Theater in Simpsonville, and they have a curtain on stage, usually, and it either goes this way or it goes up. But as you go to that theater, and then they began to dim the lights. And then the spotlights turn on. They begin to move on that curtain. And everybody begins to get to their seats because they know that that curtain is about to reveal what is behind it. It's going to unveil a story for the audience to see. In Matthew chapter 16, from this point forward, Jesus begins to reveal more of himself. He begins to get more intense and more precise in who he is. And he's marching to the cross now. And you're going to find that from this point to Calvary, you're going to see an intense dialogue between Jesus and his disciples, but at the same time, between Jesus and the people of Jerusalem. Jesus is going to be more definitive, more defined. He is going to unveil himself. He's going to reveal himself more vividly than he has before. And I want you to understand this. Up to this point, the crowds have gathered. The multitudes have come. He has healed sick, raised dead, give sight to blind. He has preached amazing messages. He has a following of disciples, but we know chronologically that John 6 has already happened. If you read John 6, there was a monstrous crowd following Jesus, and he turned around, and they were there following him because he had just fed them a day before, bread and fish. And he looked at them and said, "You were only here for a meal." He said, "The bread that I fed you is temporary. Moses gave manna in the wilderness, but I have come to give you life, and I am the bread of life. And unless you're willing to eat my flesh, drink my blood, you are not worthy to follow me." And that scattered the crowd greatly. It dwindled down. They all left because they thought, this guy's crazy. Except for the 12. Even some of Jesus' disciples left. And Jesus looked at the 12 remaining and said, "Will you leave too?" And Peter said, "Where else can we go? You're the only ones, only one that has the word of truth." That's unfolded. What I'm saying by that is this. Jesus has weeded out the people who are just there for what Jesus can do for them. He is now has a core of 12. He has 12 guys. And he's going to build a church on these guys. But he's got rid of the people who are there for their own benefit. Now, they're still thinking, man, this is going to pay off down the road. They're still got some selfishness in them. We see that in them as we read on. But they're sticking around. They're hanging in there. They're not going anywhere. And Jesus, in the first part of chapter 16, the Pharisees come to him and say, "Show us a sign. Give us a sign that you're the one." And Jesus is fed up with them. And he says, "I'm not giving you any more signs. You've seen enough signs. You've seen enough miracles." He said, "When the clouds roll in, you know it's going to rain. When it gets dark, you know it's evening time." He says, "Why is it that you can tell the weather with the clouds, but you cannot discern the signs of the times? The only sign that I'm going to show you now is the sign of Jonah. And on the third day, I will rise." Now, he didn't say that part, but he said the sign of Jonah, and he just kind of left it there. We know today, in hindsight, he's saying the only sign you're going to see now is the resurrection. When you see that, that's the only sign you need. And then he looked at the disciples and walked away and said, "Beware of the leaven of these men." Leaven is contaminating bread. He says, leaven is not good. Don't, the false teaching of these men, don't believe them. Follow me. And they did. Now, are y'all ready? Because here's what's going to happen. I'm about to hit some intense, deep theological passages in the next few weeks. Heavy-duty stuff. I got a shovel. I'm going to be digging. All right? And I'm not avoiding it. I'm just telling you, this is steak and broccoli. This is not Twinkie cakes. All right? But it is so pivotal to who we are. Jesus handles some hard subjects from here on out. He handles divorce. He handles the church. He handles his glory. He handles prophecy. The end times. Begins to get into some deep stuff. First service, it was 9:23, and I was only in the second point. So I had to move on. I had to finish it up. But I'm just telling you, this is heavy stuff. So you got to put your thinking caps on. You got to be ready to follow me, okay? But here, Jesus takes them to a place called Caesarea Philippi. And one of the greatest passages, I believe, in the Gospel of Matthew is here. In fact, I would go as far as to say that this is the foundational part of Matthew. Every book of the Bible has a key verse. John's Gospel has one. Luke has one. Every book has a key verse, a foundational thesis of why it's written. Matthew 16 here, this little dialogue that I'm about to read for you, is the foundation of Matthew. It is why he wrote it. And so here, beginning in verse 13, it says, when Jesus came into the region of Caesarea Philippi, he asked his disciples, "Who do men say that I, Son of Man, am?" And they said, "Some say that you are John the Baptist, others say Elijah, and others Jeremiah, or one of the prophets." And he said unto them, "But who do you say that I am?" You notice I read it that way? Because the "you" in Greek is emphatic. It is not "who do you say that I am?" It's "who do you say that I am?" Simon Peter replied, "You are the Christ, the Son of the living God." And Jesus answered him, "Blessed are you, Simon, son of Jonah." Isn't it funny how he just said the sign of Jonah is the next thing you're going to see? And he called Peter, son of Jonah. That's just interesting. I thought that for free. "For flesh and blood has not revealed this to you, but my Father who is in heaven. And I tell you that you are Peter, and on this rock I will build my church, and the gates of Hades, hell, shall not prevail against it. And I will give you the keys of the kingdom of heaven. And whatsoever you bind on earth shall be bound in heaven. Whatsoever you loose on earth shall be loosed in heaven." Then he commanded his disciples to tell no one that he was Jesus the Christ. That's a very familiar passage to many of us. It's a powerful passage. I don't know about you, but when I read when Peter answers the question, it just gives you goosebumps, doesn't it? Yes, you are the Christ, the Son of the living God. Go, Peter, go! Right? But here, I think it's telling. We need to learn something. You'll find in the Bible, sometimes where Jesus asks a question, or where Jesus makes a statement, says a lot about the question of the statement. Jesus took them to a certain place. He took them to Caesarea Philippi. Now don't miss this. I want to show you something special. This place, I've been there. It's a beachfront. But it's in northern Israel. It's up in the very far north. And there's Mount Hermon up there. Mount Hermon is the highest peak in Israel. And up there, it's by the beach. It's near, it's all sand, really. Some of the oldest aqueducts in the Roman Empire are in Caesarea. And you can see them. They're the only ones remaining. There are only a few remaining in the world. And they're there, and they're remaining. And those of you going to Israel, me in October, we're going to go here. You will stand in this spot and see where this dialogue took place. But Caesarea Philippi has a very symbolic background. The Greeks called it Panaeus. And the reason they called it Panaeus was because there's a spring there at the base of Mount Hermon that shoots out water. That spring is used to feed the Jordan River. But the Greeks believed it was a holy place. And they came there years before, and they built a little worship shrine there to the god Pan, P-A-N, not Peter Pan, Pan, just P-A-N. Pan was the Greek god of creation. The god of nature, who made the trees and the beauty of the nature. And they would come there, the Greeks would come there, and they would give sacrifices and offerings to the Greek god Pan. That's why they called it Panaeus. It was the ancient name of that area. And there was a little shrine there in Caesarea Philippi where it was located, and that's where it was for years and years and years. Then the Romans conquered it. And Caesar Augustus came in there, and he took that region, that whole area, and he gave it to his buddy, Herod the Great. The same Herod who killed all the babies in Bethlehem, that Herod, he gave that region to Herod. And so that Herod built this beautiful city there. It had a beautiful marina with boats. It would look like Charleston. I mean, just all kinds of beautiful boats. It was a beautiful place, beautiful vacation spot. In fact, all Roman leaders would live there. That's where Pontius Pilate lived. He didn't live in Jerusalem. He hated it there because there was too much religious fighting. He would stay up in Caesarea. He'd only come down for Passover. They stayed up there. It was pretty. Why not? It's Miami. Why would you not want to stay? It's beautiful. And so they there and they owned it. And it was this beautiful metropolis. And then when Herod the Great died, his son Philip wanted to impress Caesar Augustus. Now, Augustus had been dead. He died around that time. But a new one had come over. But Caesar. So he built this beautiful temple to Caesar. Now the word Caesar is a Latin, it really is Latin for divine. God. God on earth. The Caesars believed that they were God. That's why the church got persecuted. Because they wouldn't recognize the Caesars as God. And so they'd kill them. They'd say, Jesus is God, not you. And they'd say, deny Jesus and accept Caesar as Lord. Bow to Caesar. And they would not bow to Caesar, so they were killed. So Caesar, Philip, built a temple to Caesar, the earthly god of government and Rome and the Roman Empire. He was God on earth. And he built it on top of the Greek shrine to the creator. The Greek's creator. So you have the Greek creator and God on earth, according to the Romans, being worshipped right there. And Jesus takes his disciples there and camps and says, who do you say that I am? Does it mean more now? Location, location, location. They are sitting on the backdrop of this pagan worship, this idolatry. And he asked them the unavoidable question. Who do men say that I am? He asked that first. Who do men say that I am? And they answered him. Some say you're John the Baptist. Some say you're this. Some say you're that. And he says, but who do you say that I am? Can I put it in perspective for you? It would be the equivalent of Jesus taking us and standing us in front of Wall Street as you watch the Dow move. And Jesus saying, who do men say that I am? Who do you say that I am? It would be the equivalent of Jesus taking us to Washington, D.C. and standing us on the Capitol steps. Or in front of the Supreme Court building where rulings are made, where government operates, and we hang on every ruling and every piece of legislation and every tick of the gas price. And every movement of interest rates and inflation. And we watch the banter back and forth and the spitting contests that we watch day in and day out down in that city. And we worry, our worry is based on who wins and who loses. Up and down, whether this one's got it or that one's got it. If that one gets it, we burn everything down. If that one gets it, we go tear everything up. We pitch fits because our people are not in there promoting our agenda. We put all of our hopes, and I'm not saying some of these things are not important. I'm just saying we put all of our hope and our trust in the things of God down here, the gods of this world. our finances, our Wall Street, our government officials, the people who, and they do, by the way, they'll never say it, but our politicians, a lot of them, not all of them, but a lot of them believe they are God on earth. I'm just going to say it. When you kill babies in a womb, you're playing God. Bottom line, when you do this, when you redefine things that God has defined, when you begin to tell people this is truth and that is not, government should not be telling the church what truth is. But they do. And many of us believe that, and our worry is based on what is happening. But Jesus, if he walked us in front of Capitol Hill and said, "Who do you say that I am?" Or he took us to the 50-yard line at Clemson or Columbia or Tuscaloosa or wherever your preference. How many people, have you ever met people who won't come to church on Sunday when their team lose on Saturday? They don't want to deal with the trouble. They don't want to deal with the heckling. It means too much. Have you ever tried to plan a church event during a football game? When you have to look at a calendar and go, when's Clemson playing? When's Gamecocks playing? When we have to do that, that tells me, and it tells me, and it tells you, when Jesus would look at us and go, "Who do you say that I am?" Jesus took them to the place where the world is saying the God of the Roman Empire is Caesar and the God of creation is Pan. And he says, "What about you? Do you believe that? Or do you believe in me?" It's an unavoidable question. We all must answer it. We answer it when we get saved, but we answer it every day. It's not a question you get saved one time, but it's a question you'll have to answer in your sanctification through your life every day. You will answer it when you are tempted. You will answer it when you're tested. You will answer it when you're angry. You'll answer it when you're frustrated. You'll answer it when you're afraid. You'll answer it when you're dying. Who is Jesus to you? He is Christ, the Son of the living God. An unavoidable question. And Peter gets up and says, "You're Christ." That's the word for Messiah. You're the Messiah. You're the one we've been waiting for. You are the Son of the living God, not a dead one. Notice he said dead one. You know why? Because Pan was dead. Pan was the god of the Greek. It was dead. It didn't exist. Paul says they're dead. They don't talk. Paul says that in the epistles. He says, "Why do y'all worship things that don't talk? You make them with your hands and pray to them." That's stupid. Right? They're dead gods. All Caesars die. All presidents die. All football stars die. All of our money goes to somebody else. It all dies. But we worship a living God. You are the Christ, the Son of the living God. And Jesus looked at him and he said, "You're right. You got it, Pete." And then he unveiled a secret. He revealed a secret that had not been revealed. Really, Jesus had not really truly declared himself like this yet. And Peter declares it and he says, "You're right. That is who I am." But he also reveals another secret, the church. The word "reveal" here, he said, "Flesh and blood, Peter, did not reveal this to you." The word "reveal" is apocalypse. Apocalypto. When you hear apocalypse, what do you think? World's coming to an end, right? Clouds are opening up. War, Armageddon, everything's falling apart, right? Apocalypse. Really, apocalypse means to unveil, to reveal, revelation. That's why I call this the reveal section. Jesus is revealing his church to us. He's revealing himself to us, who he really is in essence, and who he is truly, and what he came to do. And he says here, he says, "You answered right." And he said, "Peter, Petros." Now, I want you to notice something. Now, I'm getting a little wordy here. I don't want to bore you with it. But I think it's so important to to understand this part. Petros, he says, and your name is Petros, which means little rock, little stone. It really doesn't mean anything impressive. It means little stone, little bitty. He says, your name is Petros, and on this Petra, I will build my church. The first time he says it, he says, your name is Petros, little rock. Second time he says, upon this Petra, it means foundation. Stone foundation, mountain, big rock. You have a little rock, big rock. He says, Peter, you're a little rock, but I'm going to build on a big rock. Upon this Petra, I will build my church. I will build. I will build. Boy, that takes the pressure off me and off you. Doesn't mean we shouldn't witness, but it means God does the supernatural stuff. We do the natural. He does the supernatural. God does the moving. God does the shaking. God does the convicting. God does the power. God does the miraculous. We just do the obedient part, what he tells us to do. We're like disciples. We hand out the bread and fish. God multiplies it. He said, I will build my church. You're his wife. You're his. You're not mine. Y'all don't belong to me. You don't even belong to each other. We don't belong to the Baptists. We don't belong to anybody but Jesus himself. He says, this is mine. But this is the first time. Are y'all with me so far? This is the first time he's revealed this secret. He has never mentioned this before. Never has it been mentioned in the Old Testament. You will not find the word church in the Old Testament. The word is ecclesia. It is a called out assembly of people. There's going to be a calling sent out, and he's going to draw them. It's a body of people that will come together who are called. A called assembly that is solemn. And he said, I'm going to build this thing. I'm going to build a called out body of believers. You can be together in one place and be an assembly, an ecclesia. You can be all separated all over the globe and be an ecclesia. You are a body of called believers. You can move. You're an organism. You're not a stationary building. You're a moving body of people who have been called by God to salvation. And he says, I will build my church, my called out assembly, and I will build it on what? On a rock, a foundation. What is the foundation? There's been a lot of debate over that. Catholics would say it's Peter. Protestants would say it's Jesus. You say, Pastor, which is it? Yes. It doesn't always have to be either or. You say, what do you mean? Peter will be the first pastor of it. He will be the first proclaimer of it. I would say, I hesitate to say it's not Jesus, because Jesus is the heart of all this. But it's not Peter nor Jesus alone here. It is what Peter just said. That's the rock. When Peter looks at Jesus and says, upon this rock, or he says, you are the Christ, the Son of the living God. That's the foundation of who we are. We don't believe he's a prophet. He's the Christ, the Son of the living God. We don't believe he's another religion. He's the Christ, the Son of the living God. He's not a temporary Messiah. He's an eternal Messiah. He's not an angel that's brothers with Satan, like those Jehovah's Witnesses that knock on your door will say. No, he's an eternal God. He come down in human flesh. He is here. He is our Savior. He died, and upon that rock, the truth of who Jesus is, the Christ, the Son of the living God, we all must believe in that and have faith. When I baptize these people, what I ask them? Do you believe Jesus is the only way? Yes. On this, by the authority of the church and by the authority of Jesus himself, I baptize you. It is the belief in who Jesus is. That is the foundation of our church. You all are a part of the church because, one, there was a time in your life when you put your faith in who Jesus was. You can believe Jesus existed. You can believe Jesus lived. You can believe all that. You can meet Muslims who believe Jesus lived and existed. You can meet Christians who believed he lived and existed. Did you know 89% of the American public believe Jesus is, he lived? He's alive? I think it's higher than that. I believe it was 89 or 98. I'm going dyslexic this morning. It's either 98 or 89. I can't remember. I read it the other day. I should have wrote it down. But you won't find a problem getting people to believe he existed. But head knowledge and heart knowledge are two different things. You know, William Carey, the great missionary in India, translated the Bible into 27 different languages in India. Did you know he had 31 Hindu workers that worked with him, helping him translate that Bible into different languages? And you know, record shows that not one of them got saved. They held the word in their hands in 27 different languages, but they didn't have him in their hearts. It is who he is, and the gospel is who he is. He is the Christ. He's the Savior of the world. That is the foundation. And he says, Petros, you little rock, I'm going to build a foundation on what you just said, you little rock. And I am going to build a church. I'm going to build it on that foundation, Peter. You know you're little rocks too. We are all little rocks. Little pebbles that make up one solid structure. We all come. Boy, you keep laying rocks. You know, if you go to Israel to the Jacob's Well, it used to be so deep. Now it's this deep, now it's this deep. What's the difference? Over the years, teenagers kept kicking rocks in there. And every year, every generation, every so many hundred years, it keeps getting higher and higher. That bucket hits sooner than it used to. One pebble after another builds a huge difference, makes a huge difference. The church started out with a deep, now it's coming bigger and bigger and bigger. We're a bunch of rocks coming together under a foundation called the gospel of Jesus Christ and who he is. And we build a church through the power of who he is. Amen? It is an unstoppable church. I know this is heavy duty, but y'all are hanging with me. Y'all don't look tired yet. You okay? And then he says about it, he says this, he says, it's unstoppable. Now remember, this has not been mentioned yet. Satan didn't know what it was. You will find no verse in the Old Testament said there's a church coming. Nothing. That word was not, it didn't exist. An ecclesia, none of it. He didn't use that language. Now there are verses that say God's going to draw the Gentiles. God's going to, you have pictures of the bride and the groom in Song of Solomon and different places. You have all these prophecies that kind of point to it, but nothing straight out, nothing right out of the mouth. There's nothing identifying it to look for it. But Jesus here reveals a secret. And he says, Peter, you couldn't have came up with all this on your own. Only God can reveal these secrets, who I am and what I'm building. And he said, I'm going to build an ecclesia. Imagine being the devil and you're listening. And you hear this for the first time. They had no idea. And he goes, whoa. Stop the prayer. What did he say? What did Jesus just say? He's going to build an assembly of what? He's going to build a called out body of believers that'll have power like him? And the gates of hell cannot prevail? What? Skirmish, fear. What do we do with these people? What are we going to do when this happens? We had no idea. Satan was trembling. Listen to me. You are much more afraid of, Satan is much more afraid of you than you are of him. You should be. He is much more afraid of us than we should be of him. You know why? Because we got a rock. And it's a body that Jesus himself is building. And Jesus said, it's unstoppable. You cannot stop it. It'll be like nothing. The gates of Hades is the word here. Death. We go to a funeral home and cry and weep because people die. Jesus here says, fear not, church. The doors that people go in of death, don't be afraid. I am building something where the church cannot be touched by death. You have nothing to be afraid of. The gates of hell cannot stop you. Satan can't stop the church. Sin can't stop the church. Sinners cannot stop the church. But I tell you what can stop the church. The church. The greatest enemy we've got is ourselves. Because Satan knows, I can't stop this thing. If these people are locked in with Jesus, there's no way to stop them. There's no way to slow them down. I can't. But let's get them distracted at least. Let's slow them down. Let's see if we can get them mad at one another. Let's see if we can get them offended so they don't get plugged in anywhere. Let's get them distracted and find other gods, things that they will follow instead of me. Let's get them hooked on a drug. Let's get them hooked on alcohol. Let's get them locked in. Get them hooked on pornography. Get them when they're young. We'll save them when they're little, walk them through a baptistry pool when they're 7, 8, 9 years old, and he'll throw a pornography switch at them when they're 12. The only thing he can do is slow it down. And we have the right to choose whether we bite the bait or not. The greatest hindrance to the church is the church. Because Jesus said it is unstoppable. It is an unstoppable church. Hades cannot stop it. And lastly, this is where I was. I just shut it down after this in the first service. I felt so bad. You have an unbelievable responsibility. An unavoidable question: who is Jesus to you? An unstoppable church that you're a part of if you're a believer. But with that comes an unbelievable responsibility. Because Jesus here says, Peter, I'm going to give you the keys to the Ferrari. How many of you would, you know, many things, you may have a Ferrari in your garage. You would have to love your pastor a lot to give me the keys to drive it without you. Right? You say, I'll go with you, Pastor. You can ride with me. Or you can drive it with me sitting with you, but take it whenever you want. Right? Nor would I want you to, because I may wreck it and I'd feel awful. But Jesus here says, I'm about to give you the keys to the most prized possession I have. My church. And you are going to have full access to open the doors to let people in. Let me put it in modern terms for you. He's giving you the password to his iPhone. See, you get a phone, you get these iPhones, and they do a lot of wonderful things. But unless you know the password, you know, you got to hit the password to get in, or your face ID. Jesus, listen, oh, this is good. Oh, it just came to me. Jesus is going to put his face on your face and open the phone. Won't that preach? Y'all remember? Isn't that true? We are in him, right? So we can pick up his iPhone and go like that, and it pops open, and there's a whole new world that we have access to. It's called the kingdom of God. And you know what? We can open it up to anybody that comes and wants in. We know how to help them get in there. The key is faith in Jesus. And we say, hey, you want Jesus? We got him for you. Here, come here. We've got the keys. He gave us the keys. And he says, you can open the doors of heaven and bring them in if you give them the key, which is me. And then you can chain up all the bad stuff. You can bind all the addictions and all the sins and all the junk and all the terrible things. You have the power, church, to go in and knock it to the moon. kick it out of their life and bring them to me and save them. Here's the keys. What an unbelievable responsibility. You see why I slowed down a little bit? There's a lot here. Jesus is saying, let me open the box. Let me show you what's inside. All those other people who wanted me for bread in their stomachs, they're gone. But those of you who've stayed behind, I got something to show you. First of all, who am I? You got it right, Peter. Upon this, I'm going to do something special, and I'm going to build this beautiful thing called the ecclesia, and it's going to be so powerful. It's going to permeate the world. It's going to take over. The devil's going to tremble and shake because I'm inside of it, building it one rock at a time and on a foundation of truth, and it'll never be able to be changed. Wow. But let me ask you, who is Jesus to you today? There are some people who get saved and they run away from God. And when they got saved, he was their Christ, but they have disobeyed him somewhere down the line, and it's plaguing them to pieces. They're in shackles and chains. You have put chains back on that were originally taken off, and you forgot who Jesus was to you. And you know, there are times in a Christian's life they have to come back to the foot of the cross and say, Lord, they don't get saved again. You get saved the first time, but you're like a prodigal son that comes home. And you have to come to yourself, and you got to go back to the source of your life. You need a revival in your life. And you may be here today, and that is you. You need a revival in your life. Today, when you got saved, Jesus was the Christ, the Son of the living God. But today, you've forgotten who he is in your life, and it's affecting you. You're heaven bound, but you're earthly broke. Because you got all these weights you're trying to carry that you put back on, and God's saying, tear them off. Run the race without weights. Get them things off. You got more to do. But many of you, you may have not have been saved at all. You have a lot of head knowledge, but not a lot of heart knowledge. Nothing. You need to repent and say, Lord, you are the Son of God to me. You are the way to heaven. You are the eternal destiny of my life. You are the one and the only. And I want to tell you that. But some of you, you got to realize that the church is unstoppable. But you may feel pretty stopped right now. You know you're unstoppable? Well, if you're stopped, it ain't God. What's holding you up? It's you. Something in your life. Be unstoppable. You go to God and you say, what is it, God, that's stopping me from moving forward? And he'll reveal it. And you get rid of it. You repent of it. And you move on. And you start running. And number three, you may realize, you may not realize, but you have an unbelievable responsibility. We do as a church. I heard that song being sung. My goosebumps were moving as I'm hearing that. He will build his church. He will build his church. Who's he going to use? Me. Who's he going to use? You. I'm so glad I am the nail and the hammer that builds the house of God. Aren't you? But don't let him put you away because he can't use you because you've got dull. Or you won't listen, or you're unusable. Get up. Get right. Come back. Run. Amen? Let's stand together. Father, I don't know where people are. They may want to come join our church today. Today's the day they've waited for to do it. They may want to come to be baptized. Lord, I pray they will come. They may want to come and just pray at this altar and give you some things. They may want to come, Lord, and be saved. Whatever it is, Lord, I pray you'll do the work. In Jesus' name, amen. Let's sing together.
We are the change. The world is waiting.
That you will do your work. Lord, the work is not done when we say amen. You continue to work on hearts. And Lord, I pray that we will be a church that is unstoppable because we're on that foundation. And Lord, that we will take it very seriously, what you've called us to do. Lord, we love you in Jesus' name.